So I am super happy to have you here. I haven't had you on the show before, so I'm super excited to be able to have a one-on-one with you. Before we get started, why don't you introduce everybody to who you are and what kind of art you create?
Oh, okay. Well, first off, I'm really happy to be here. So honored. I'm Angela Carole Brown, and I'm a writer, a musician, and a visual artist.
Awesome. Wonderful work. I'm not biased at all. Not at all. wonderful work all around.
Thank you.
I'm going to jump right into a big question. And I know these first couple of questions that I'm going to ask you, you actually answered very brilliantly in your piece, but I just want you to kind of talk about it. What role do you think creatives play, and what responsibility do creatives have in the midst of crises like both the pandemic and like world sickness, as well as the protest atmosphere?
Well, we have a pretty rich history of artists, you know, responding to and refracting light off of or even onto, you know, whatever is unfolding in a society, especially when there's calamity. The German Expressionists, you know, during the time of Hitler and the Third Reich, I mean, that movement gave us an incredible body of work, and it was in response to something pretty calamitous and pretty dark in our history. The civil rights movement here in the States in the 60s, you had your singers and songwriters and troubadours who were reflecting the need, or even to extend that back to slavery and the slave songs and the spirituals that came out of the fields. Artists have always historically responded to times of despair. And, you know, I mean, sometimes the expression is a shout and an appeal. Sometimes the expression is a cautionary tale. And so now here we are. We just got out of another pretty calamitous time in our world history. Or we're not completely out of it, but you know, 2020 was the breeding ground for all kinds of madness. And you know, that is precisely when artists tend to get into gear, because the soil is rich for reflecting and examining a society and what it's going through and what's gone wrong and why. We don't necessarily answer those questions, but we pose them, you know, in the books we write and the music we write and the paintings we paint and the films we make or whatever is your particular medium. And the world might not even, I mean, people might not even be consciously aware that that is a need. But in hindsight, people have always been able to look back and go, oh my God, you know, this artist or that piece or that book. And there's a reason that they last. There's a reason that they stand the test of time, because they're addressing something quite weighty.
Because I've had the pleasure of sitting around the table with you and talking. So our family, for those who don't know, Angela's also my cousin. Our family, we're a family of creatives. There are many artists in our family, writers, singers, songwriters, actors. And so I've had the pleasure of sitting around and just older generations. We have a very strong base of matriarchs that have also had these conversations with us. And so I wonder if maybe you could speak to the power of art as you've seen it through the ages and even through the eyes of the shepherd women and men who had beautiful voices and were singers and performers before you, before I. I wonder if maybe you could talk about it from that perspective and maybe if and or how that has impacted your path in the moment of 2020.
Well, I think there is much to be learned from the ancestors. And you know, and even the immediates that have come before us, there's much to learn. I also think there's much to learn from those that are younger than us. You know, I've always said, and I know this doesn't exactly speak to your question, but I do want to share this. Mm-hmm. I think that the youth is where romance still lives. And, you know, you get to a certain age, you get kind of old and crusty and jaded. And there is something to be learned from those who are still idealistic, for those who still have belief and faith, you know, in our world. When, you know, like I say, you get a certain age, you start to get really jaded and you start to get really cynical. And there's a lot to be learned from the youth, from your generation. And also, may I say, I just heard this today and I thought, oh, I've got to make sure I say this at some place. But they say that it takes three generations to change the world. And you are three generations away from the Martin Luther King's generation. And so, you know, you are in the set stage for changing the world, your generation. And I bow to you and I honor you for that. At the same time, you know, our ancestors have so much to teach us, and we would be losing if we felt like nobody had anything to teach us. And I think it's important to especially take from those who were a part of the civil rights movement, that were a part of the lunch counter sit-ins, that were a part of the marches. And we are learning from them, because I feel like we have come back to that. Mm-hmm. I mean, 2020 definitely, actually even the last 5 years have awakened the marches again in a way that we hadn't seen in decades, you know. And I always used to think, you know, as I was growing up, I would look back at the 50s and the 60s and I would think, oh man, I'm not a part of a generation that's doing anything. You know, where are our Martin Luther Kings, and where are our Rosa Parks, and where are our John Lewis's, you know? And to see it start to blossom all over again. I mean, on the one hand, the fact that it's needed is problematic, but the truth is that is the reality of life. And we will always have to come back to it. But the fact that we have the ability to come back to it and taking the stand to come back to it is lovely, is wonderful, is because we're paying attention to the ancestors, to the people before us who have done it.
I like that. For you, because you have // in your in your title, and you've got many different art forms. I'm just curious: is there an art form that you found it easier? You're an author of books. You are a poet. You are a singer. You're a songwriter. You're a musician. You're a painter. Is there one that you found particularly difficult or particularly easy to kind of fall into in the midst of all of this craziness?
Sure. Yes, I would say writing was the one I could go to and find respite in and work out things that are roiling in my own head. Mm-hmm. You know, singing is what I made my living doing for like 3 decades. Mm-hmm. And so it was the thing I did the most and had the most concerted focus on. And of course, I mean, you can do it in a room alone, but it really is a very social medium. You have musicians that you play with. You know, you aren't singing in a vacuum. Like I say, you can, yeah. But it wasn't what I was doing for 30 years. I was singing with bands and singing with various musicians. And, you know, and it was also my living. So there was a pragmatic element to it too. You have to book the gig. You have to write the checks, or somebody writes the check to you. You hire a musician, or a musician hires you. You have to show up. You have to be accountable to others, mm-hmm. you know, beyond yourself. And because of the social nature of it, and because of the working, making a living nature of it, of course, that all got just vanished when this pandemic occurred and we all went into quarantine. So it was, I couldn't really do that. And that was not a choice. That was taken from me. The other art forms that I do are much more solitude, isolating environment art forms. Mm-hmm. They are about turning inward. And so no one can take that from you. And so I've found, you know, writing I've done for 45 years, painting is fairly newer to me. So the writing was the natural place, the instinctive place. And I'll tell you this as well. There was a good long few months into this pandemic where I was just in that state of paralysis. And what it took in my case was a prompting by someone outside of myself. So for example, you inviting me to be a part of this project of yours and asking if I would contribute an essay. You know, it's like my pilot light was a little out and you ignited it. You know, and from there, the door was open.
Looking back on the words that you wrote, and the knowledge that you, with the knowledge that you have today, that we do have a new vaccine, we do have a new administration, we are hoping that even some of the things that were happening that prompted all of the protests, we're hoping that some of those things can be addressed at an executive level. What feelings do you have sitting in this exact moment?
Yes.
Looking back on what you wrote and also looking forward at what could come. Right. What feelings do you have there?
That I feel hopeful for the first time in a long time, but I have to remember that that can't allow me to get complacent, that the work still has to be done. Mm-hmm. Yeah.
Well, I feel like I could ask you, like in my head, I'm like, I could ask her this, I could ask her that. There are a billion other questions, but we're going to have you back on the show. So that's exciting. Why don't you tell everybody where they can find your work right now, how they can find you?
Oh, okay. So my website is angelacarolebrown.com. It's Carol with an E at the end, but even if you forget that, you can find me. and I also, my blog is bindygirlchronicles.com. And all my books are available. I have CDs in the jazz and the folk vein. I am doing art commissions for the Alcohol Inks, which has been my newest visual art medium in the past year and a half. That's been fun. And I did want to give a little plug to my little children's video book, which is the most recent thing I put out, and which I have to also credit, you know, this time in 2020 where we all had to isolate, because that's a project that's been roiling and trying to get out of me for 40 years. And I finally thought, well, this has got to happen this year. And part of the reason it had to happen this year is because I was afforded the time. If there's nothing else positive we could take from 2020, we can take that there was the gift of time.
Yeah.
So there was that, I was able to get it done, but also, you know, it's a story about peace and about compassion and about gratitude. And I felt like, well, we need a jolt of that in 2020, don't we? So that got accomplished anyway. That's the newest thing I put out, but all of that you can find on my website.
I'm going to try and put that one on your landing page as well. So if you're watching the video, you're likely watching the video. Look below this video and you'll find the link to that on YouTube. I'm going to put that on there as well. I've already sent it to my friends who have babies. And so
thank you.
I'm excited to keep talking to you about it. And I look forward to having you on the show with some other artists.
I look forward to that too.
Yeah. Yeah. Thank you so much.
Thank you.